In the previous parts of this video series regarding the brain anatomy, I have shown the superficial visible structures of a human brain. In this part, that is the part 4 of the 5-part video series on human brain anatomy, I will show the deeper brain structures revealed on removing the cerebral cortex and other brain structures one after another. Now you can see the inner white matter of the cerebral cortex after removal of the outer gray matter. Gray matter is distinguished from the white matter in that it contains numerous cell bodies and relatively few myelinated axons, while white matter contains relatively few cell bodies and is composed of chiefly long-range myelinated axons. The color difference arises mainly from the whiteness of the myelin. On removal of the white matter as well as one of the cerebral hemisphere, you see the medial surface of the opposite side hemispheres. Deeper to this cerebral hemisphere is the corpus callosum, which is formed of the association fibers linking the cerebral hemisphere of each side. The other structures deeper to the cerebral cortex include the hidden insular cortex, the cerebral ventricles, the thalamus, the limbic system, and the basal ganglia. On focusing onto the medial surface of the cerebral cortical hemispheres, you can see in order from front to back the subcallosal area, superior frontal cortex, paracentral lobule, precuneus and cuneus and lingular gyrus. The paracentral lobule is the medial continuation of the precentral and postcentral gyri. The precuneus and cuneus are the medial portions of the superior parietal lobule and the occipital lobe respectively. The cuneus receives visual information of the contralateral inferior visual field. The lingular part of the occipital lobe is believed to play an important role in visual memory, identification and recognition of words and dreaming. The mental imagery concerning the self, that is, rating one's own personality traits compared to those judged of other people, has been located in the forward part of the precuneus, with posterior areas being involved with episodic memory. Episodic memory is the memory of everyday events such as times, location, geography associated with emotions and other contextual information. As mentioned before in the part 2 of this video series, now you will see the cortical homunculus, that is a neurological map of the human brain areas dedicated for different parts of the body processing motor or sensory functions. The sequential representation of the body parts in the primary motor area is in the following order, with voluntary muscle movements in the head being represented in inferior parts of the gyrus and of the lower extremities being represented in superior portions. Similarly, in the primary sensory area, with sensations from the head being represented in inferior parts of the gyrus and impulses from the lower extremities being represented in superior portions. As you can see, the genitals, toes, foot, and lower leg are represented at the medial surface of the cerebral hemisphere, and then as one moves down the hemisphere progressively, higher parts of the body are represented, assuming a body that is faceless and has arms raised. Accordingly, the further order of the arrangement is thigh, body, neck, head, arms, hands, fingers with large area for thumb. Going further down the cortex, the different areas of the face are represented in approximately top to bottom order rather than a bottom to top order, that is, as before. That is the eye, face, lips, and tongue. The cortical homunculus is split in half with the motor and sensory representations for the left side of the body on the right side of the brain and vice versa. On complete removal of both hemispheres, you see the cingulate part of the cerebral cortex. The entire cingulate gyrus, which lies immediately above the corpus callosum. The cingulate cortex is the part of the limbic lobe. When we are worried or anxious, it is our cingulate gyrus that acts. It helps us express our emotional state through gesture, posture, and movement. Now you can see the parts of the cingulate gyrus. The corpus callosum provides a communication link between corresponding regions of the cerebral hemispheres and association fibers connecting different regions of a single hemisphere. Attached to the lower part of the corpus callosum is the septum pellucidum. It is a thin triangular vertical double membrane separating the anterior horns of the left and right lateral ventricles of the brain. The septum pellucidum consists of two layers of laminae of both white and gray matter. Now you can see the parts of the corpus callosum. The end part of the corpus callosum towards the cerebellum is called the splenium. This is the thickest part and it communicates somatosensory information between the two halves of the parietal lobe and the visual cortex at the occipital lobe. The trunk of the corpus callosum lies between the splenium and the genu. It interconnects areas of the motor cortex. The front part of the corpus callosum towards the frontal lobe is called the genu or knee. It interconnects the prefrontal cortex. The genu curves downward and backward in front of the septum pellucidum, diminishing greatly in thickness to form the thinner part called the rostrum and is connected below the lamina terminalis, which we will see later on further exposure of deeper structures. Now, this stretches from the interventricular foramina to the recess at the base of the optic stalk. The rostrum is named for its resemblance to a bird's beak. Now you see the triangular area called the insular cortex, which is not visible from the surface of the cerebrum as it is folded medially into the lateral sulcus. It can be seen in the intact brain only by separating the frontal and the parietal lobes from the temporal lobe. The insular lobe is involved in sensory and motor visceral functions and taste perception. The structures you will now see are parts of the basal ganglia, which are large gray masses of nerve cells called nuclei. Four basal ganglia can be distinguished, that is, the putamen, the globus pallidus, the caudate nucleus, and the substantia nigra. The putamen lies deep within the cortex of the insular lobe. The globus pallidus consists of two parts, the lateral and the medial. Together, the putamen and the adjacent globus pallidus are referred to as the lentiform nucleus. The thalamus, although shown now, is not a part of the basal ganglia. Being located between the cerebral cortex and the midbrain, it has extensive nerve connections to both. The primary functions of the thalamus is to relay motor and sensory signals to the cerebral cortex. It also regulates sleep, alertedness, and wakefulness. The third basal ganglia nucleus is the caudate nucleus. The caudate nucleus has a C-shaped configuration that parallels the lateral ventricle. The head of the caudate nucleus protrudes into the anterior horn of the lateral ventricle. The body lies above and lateral to the thalamus, and the tail is in the roof of the inferior horn of the lateral ventricle. The tail of the caudate nucleus ends in relationship to amygdaloid nucleus nuclear complex. Together, the caudate nucleus, putamen, and globus pallidus form the corpus striatum. The cerebral ventricles you see now are cavities filled with cerebrospinal fluid that form the ventricular system deep within the white matter of the cerebral hemispheres. Most of the cerebrospinal fluid is produced in the ventricles, and about 70% of it is secreted by choroid plexus. These cavities include a pair of C-shaped lateral ventricles with anterior horn, inferior and posterior horns protruding into the frontal, temporal and occipital lobes respectively. The fluid drains via the interventricular foramina into the slit-like third ventricle, which is situated along the midline of the brain, separating the symmetrical halves of the thalamus and hypothalamus. Here, you see the choroid plexus, a collection of blood vessels in the wall of the lateral ventricles secreting cerebrospinal fluid. From where the fluid passes through the cerebral aqueduct in the midbrain and into the fourth ventricle in the hindbrain. Openings in the fourth ventricle permit cerebrospinal fluid to enter subarachnoid spaces surrounding both the brain and the spinal cord. Now, focusing on the fornix. The fornix, meaning arch in Latin, is a C-shaped bundle of nerve fibers in the brain that act as the major output tract of the hippocampus. The fornix is the part of the limbic system. The fibers begin in the hippocampus on each side and end in the mammillary body. The columns of fornix end in the mammillary body, not seen here. Now, you see the body of the fornix. Also seen here is the striae terminalis, which is one of the major efferent of the amygdala. The lateral portions of the body of the fornix are joined by the commissure of fornix, also called the hippocampal commissure. The crura, or posterior pillars of the fornix, are prolonged backward from the body. Further, it lies along the concavity of the hippocampus. Damage to the fornix can cause difficulty in recalling long-term information, such as details of past events. The hippocampus is a part of the limbic system and plays important roles in consolidation of information from short-term memory to long-term memory and spatial memory that enables navigation. In Alzheimer's disease and other forms of dementia, the hippocampus is one of the first regions of the brain to suffer damage. The pineal gland or body is a small endocrine gland in the brain. It produces melatonin hormone, which modulates sleep patterns in both circadian and seasonal cycles. The amygdala is an almond-shaped nucleus, Greek word amygdale meaning almond, underlying the uncus part of the temporal lobe. This nucleus has reciprocal connections with the hypothalamus and regions of the cerebral cortex. It plays a role in mediating many aspects of emotional learning and behavior, ranging from joy to sadness, disgust to excitement, and regret to satisfaction. The stria terminalis is one of the major output pathways of the amygdala, carrying signals to the septal nuclei, hypothalamic and thalamic areas of the brain. It also carries fibers projecting from these areas back to the amygdala. Stria terminalis is thought to act as a relay site within the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis and regulate its activity in response to acute stress. The striae medullaris is a fiber bundle that is considered part of the epithalamus. It projects from a number of areas, for example, limbic system and basal ganglia, to the habenula. It sends information to the areas of the midbrain that are involved in dopamine release, such as the substantia nigra and ventral tegmental area. In my next video of this series, I will show the structures at the base of the brain. For the viewers who have watched only few parts of this video series, I would advise them to watch all 5 parts in sequential order to understand the whole brain anatomy clearly.